In a speech, President Theodore Roosevelt said, "Thank God for the iron in the blood of our fathers." We owe a lot to those who've gone before us, those who paved the way. Back then, a man earned his reputation in real ways. He paid his dues. He took risks. He worked hard, and he stood for something. The unknown world was rapidly disappearing. The frontier was fading. But the frontier is exactly what these thrill seekers and risk takers needed. Somewhere to test themselves. To see what they were made of. To see what nature's made of. And see who's the meaner of the two. Now this mindset seems to have disappeared from our present culture. The frontier is fading, but it still exists. The thrill seekers and risk takers are fewer, but they're still out there. They're pushing the limits, finding their own type of enjoyment. They're not doing it for recognition or fame. They're doing it for themselves, for their own risks and their own thrills, as they choose to find refuge in the sea. Alaska, the last frontier. There are few better places to seek thrills and take risks than a place like this, where the land is tough and the unknown still exists. Just hours off the plane and the crew got hit with a heavy dose of reality. It was cold, wet, and miserable. The first fish they found was half chewed by a local bear. And with fresh tracks all around them, these surfers were a little rattled and out of their element. But not enough to keep them from hitting foot patrol and finding some salmon for dinner.
All your mothers and your brothers and your sisters and your fathers and everybody walking this land, no matter your race, your creed, your tribe, whose nation you defend, with open hearts, open minds, lend a helping hand each time to the mothers and the brothers and the sisters and the fathers, everybody walking this land. All you believers, pretenders, bona fide sinners, everybody walking this land. No matter your church, your faith, your sign, who's lying in your den, all seeing eyes in Jesus Christ. right. We're all living in a paradise with believers, pretenders, bona fide sinners, everybody walking this land.
Levi was itching to swap out his waders for a wetsuit and surf a beach break they had heard about from a local fisherman. With about 10 millimeters of rubber on, Levi felt like a baby seal in what he assumed were shark-infested waters. He decided to stay in the air as long as possible. Guide for the trip showed up the next day, none other than Jason Ratboy Collins, aerial specialist and Santa Cruz legend. Ratboy is about as salty as they come, now a commercial fisherman by trade. Ratboy bought a spread of land up in Alaska and built a house on it. He's been spending a lot more time up there to focus on the Ratboy essentials: solitude, cold water ramps, and barn doors. He agreed to show Lucas, Damo, and Levi all that Alaska has to offer. The guys were blown away. Damo, who's been just about everywhere, called it the most visually stimulating trip he's ever been on. Lucas called it a loner's paradise. He was about 2 salmon, 1 barrel, and 3 beautiful mountainscapes away from dropping everything, moving north, and building a house next to Rats. Rats said, "Go find your own spot, Grom." The boys are trading in bear tracks and salmon for warm water tubes and fish tacos with Brian Connolly. Fearless leader, ski driver, and chef didn't surf the entire trip. He said it wasn't big enough. That's a camera in Brian's hand. Way back before you could easily strap a little GoPro to your board, or to your head for that matter, Brian was carrying full-size video cameras into the full-size caverns that he was getting spat out of. British Columbia, aboard the Yak Badger. She was built in 1955 and operated as a training vessel and a minesweeper. Captain Ryan Cameron and his dad picked her up at an auction in 2004 and spent 6 years turning her into the pretty girl she is today. The perfect vessel for exploring the rugged northern coast. Where the road stops, the Yak Badger continues on.
Tree!
David Ochoa is from Portugal, a seafaring country with a rich history in sea exploration, a culture built around the sea and its provisions, and a people who've spent generations with the same dedication and mindset. It is this restlessness and maybe recklessness that has kept David on the search, in the water, away from home, and out of his comfort zone. And it's this staying out of his comfort zone that has allowed David to travel light and travel cheap. He's found if you can catch fish, that will take you pretty far in just about any culture. David has fished with locals, he slept on the beach, wandered, and dove in some pretty remarkable places along the way. Who doesn't respect a man who wears that title, who works hard, saves his money, juggles it all, then drops everything when the surf is up? Jerome Forrest of Western Australia does just that. He puts in the hard yards building houses, then charges hard when the time comes. A man can chase thrills all over the world, but sometimes that's exactly what he's doing. Chasing. The key is to find that frontier right at home, in your own backyard. Duane, Damien, Levi, and Lucas are from San Diego. And after traveling the world, they can tell you there's nothing like scoring at home. We call Lucas the pocket knife. Like a pocket knife with any job you want him around. from restoring old pongas to catching fish off them and selling his fresh catch to local fish markets, or shaping his own boards and getting barreled out of his mind on them with timeless poise and style. He does things the hard way, the right way. Everything is a craft when you have passion and understanding of the sea like Lucas does. Thank you for watching our film. We hope it has inspired you to grab your board, grab your rods, and get out there. Whether you're chasing a swell on the other side of the world or making a few casts after work, the thrills are there. Now go find refuge in the sea.
Take your breath. I hate the bitch. It's so early. We have such a good day already.
As I asked him one simple question, he looked away from me. Now he was old and lived a learned life. This man knew more than most men will. And still I asked him the same question. He retained his silence still. I stood there gazing at the trees and the ocean, wondering why he wouldn't speak. Then it came to me in one quick motion, and I apologize for interrupting his peace.
Waiters in the morning, weddies in the afternoon.
I walked away, thanking him inside for answering my questions and saving my pride. He'd answered me the only way he could, but time had taught him much, a man, and so
kind of
a
shocker for a little bit, but for a bit.
Now I know the lesson by the sea. I must have an answer. The only one to ask is me.